Dana Bourne is a retired Brigadier General in the United States Air Force. She currently serves as a co-director at the Center for Public Leadership at Harvard's John F. Kennedy School of Government. The National Preparedness Leadership Initiative is a joint program of the Center for Public Leadership and the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health. Bourne teaches a consistently well-received session in the MPLI Executive Education Program called Who Are You? Prior to joining Harvard, Bourne served two terms as the presidentially appointed Dean of the Faculty at the Air Force Academy from 2004 to 2013, where she was also a professor and head of the Behavioral Sciences and Leadership Department. Since joining the Kennedy School, she's received the school's teaching awards in 2014, 2015, 16, and 17. In 2017, she also received the school's Innovation in Teaching Award. In addition to her duties at Harvard, Bourne serves as a member of the Council on Foreign Relations, president of the Massachusetts Women's Forum, and trustee of the United States Air Force Academy's Falcon Foundation, among numerous other activities. Today, I'll speak with Bourne about her session, Who Are You?, its origins, its purpose, and its impact. Dana, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, Eric, for having me here.
The work you do, this session, Who Are You?, really gets to the core of the person of the metaleader, or the first dimension of our framework.
Right.
Talk a bit about what you see as the essence of the session that you put on.
Right. The Who Are You session really gets at, I'll give you a Mark Twain quote, because that's really the setup is the two most important days of your life are the day you're born and the day you figure out why. And the Who Are You session is really one of rediscovering the core of who you are, tie very deeply to your life story. It comes out of the foundation of authentic leadership. If we bring you into a session and we upload you with the latest leadership 1.0, and then we bring you back in another year and give you leadership 2.0, it just doesn't work. There's not the literature to back that up. And the reason is because we're all so distinctive. We're all so unique. And so focusing on who are you is getting to the distinctive value that you bring to a collective effort to lead change.
And I think as I've watched you teach this, one of the more powerful elements is when you go through this notion of competing narratives. Yeah. And one of the reasons I think it's so powerful is that it gets into the emotional side of things.
Right.
And so often the participants we get from emergency response, first responders, they're brought up in a culture of no emotion, put the emotion away.
Right. I love you bringing the fact that, you know, and I remember this as a military officer of people saying, you know, unemotionally state your case. And that always really was interesting to me because emotion is central to who we are and how we naturally react to situations. And I think that emotion is key in effective leadership to an extent because you are, first of all, when you're in an emergency situation, as you talk about, you have the amygdala hijack.
Right.
And that's something you cannot train yourself to not do. It's your natural response, which has created our survival ability. And then when you get beyond that a little bit, then you get into the, okay, now I'm embracing my head and my heart. The first exercise that I do with participants is a competing narratives exercise, which gets at this notion of connecting the head to the heart and also embracing our vulnerability. And it's really based upon Peter Drucker, who's a great thinker in leadership's quote, focus on your strengths such that your weaknesses become irrelevant. And it's a little bit of who are you from all narratives. So the competing narratives are, one, you have all of these things that you put out there that are who are you, which are on your LinkedIn account, they're on your Facebook account, they're on what you tweet, if you tweet. They're all of your bio that you have submitted and your resume. And there's those that other people also tell about you, tell your story, whether you do a letter of reference for somebody, whether you do an introduction of somebody, ultimately the obituary somebody writes on your life. And on a bad day, you read all of those because you not only walk on water, you make water that you walk on. So that's very affirming. Right. And then there's another part of our story, which is sometimes if you journal, it's what goes into your journal, or it's when you're looking in the mirror as you're shaving or brushing your teeth and you're thinking about, why didn't I? Why did I? Am I, you know, smart enough? Have I been brave enough? I mean, there's all this inter-narrative. And when you put those two things together, and also, you know, those things that maybe many people don't know, you ask, which one's the real you? And obviously, wherever you go, you are there. They right. integrate within you. And so the competing narratives exercise is one where you think about all these good things that are affirming, and then you think about one thing that is part of who you are, and it's really tied to your life story, but not many people know. But if they knew that, they would know you so much better. And when we share those narratives, there's something magical that happens. Number one, I just ask for words. Tell me about now, what are you feeling or thinking different than before we did that exercise? And the words are consistent. It's connected, trusting. I feel grateful, you know, that somebody just shared that with me. I'm inspired. They're all positive words. And then I do the same thing. I share all of my first and this, first and that. It's a little uncomfortable, mm-hmm. you know, for even them to talk about all the things you've done. And it's very uncomfortable to talk about things that are a little bit more difficult to share. They're getting a little bit more into your areas of vulnerability. And when you do, what happens is people see you as more real. They say they trust you more. Even when it's things that you share that you would think, well, you just talked about failure, mm-hmm. and people say they lean in. And so afterwards, the debrief, people really do sense that, well, then why is it that we spend so much time trying to put on a persona of perfection when we're really removing ourselves from the people we are wanting to empower and inspire and work effectively with?
It gets to a point where it's almost counterintuitive. I know this goes to Brené Brown's work as well on yes. vulnerability, that people in leadership positions often spend a lot of time trying to appear invulnerable,
right?
Which creates distance. And when you reveal that vulnerability, it doesn't make you weaker, it makes you stronger, and it actually creates a lot more trust with the people you need to build trust with.
Yes, and it's a power of vulnerability. And one of the exercises that we also do, it's more of a group exercise, looks at what happens when you act upon your strength, which is really the thing you cannot help yourself from doing. It's just who you are. And then what happens if you would allow the vulnerability or that inner voice, you know, to tell you, oh, don't do that, you know, that you're not good at that. And if you do hold back, you're basically sacrificing your gift from the situation. And that's a very powerful insight, I think, some of the participants take away.
How did you come to this?
I embraced the authentic leadership pedagogy by going through a process myself and realized that when you are able to rediscover what your life and your leadership purpose is, and we each have one that's very distinctive and it's tied typically to something in our life story, it almost like pops in terms of clarity. I can describe it a little bit as a key. Like you can have a sense of what it is you bring to a meeting, to your family, to the world. But it's like a dull key that opens the car, and it could open many cars, and you might have to work really hard to wiggle it around to make the door open where you can step in. But when you have a clarity of a purpose statement, which is very brief, but it speaks to you, it sings your song, it's a very sharp, really smooth open of the door to where you can step in and fully live your purpose. For me, it was a 2.5 day going through a session to come up with those words with the help of lots of people, helping to link together the thread of who you are with knowing your values, knowing what motivates you, both intrinsically and extrinsically, knowing who's on your support team, who do you go to for support, and embracing those tough times in your life to where you went through like setbacks or setups for comebacks, or right. where you fail forward,
right.
or like a snowboarder, you know, how you navigate through the low points in order to get to a higher high point. When people help you with that, to come with that thread that is your thread, it really is just a beautiful opportunity to step into more fulfilling and integrated life.
And so you went through a 2.5 day experience. Now in our program, the participants work with you for about 3 hours. Mm-hmm. What sort of pragmatic takeaways do you want them to walk away with?
Right. The going in, the three learning outcomes for the session for Who Are You are focused on, number one, a bit more self-awareness and the value of self-awareness as emerging leader to be more effective. With that is also self-acceptance. So we do some self-awareness and self-acceptance exercises. Another is to focus on learning and growth, as opposed to having a fixed mindset that you either have something or you don't. And then the final is this really important relationship of embracing the I and the me in order to leverage the we. And we typically jump right into the we. We're part of something bigger than ourselves, especially people who are coming to the National Preparedness Leadership Initiative. Very add public value, servant leaders, and yet the I and the me is a critical piece of how you show up in order to do that work effectively with others. As an outcome, what I hope that as people leave the session, there's a bit more of a sense of stepping up into who you are, and that will lead to more effective leadership, but also a more meaningful and fulfilling life.
Well, I know from having watched several sessions with your participants, at the end of some sessions, you say, okay, they left smarter. I know I've seen people leave changed from these exercises, because you're right, you really do get to the heart of who are you, why are you here, and why are you doing this work?
Right. Well, and Eric, as you know, there's 90-minute sessions are fairly short, but the exercises that we go through in the Who Are You session are practicing of processes that hopefully will continue throughout the remainder of their time in the program, but even more so as they leave the program and go back into doing important work, leading themselves and others.
Dana, thank you very much.
Thank you.